thank you very much, Catherine, for the kind introduction. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to present the CHAO project. So I'm really here to present the work of a really big crowd of scientists. And as you mentioned, the CHAO project is the acronym for modeling the pathogenesis of COVID-19 using the adverse outcome pathway, but it's also in order to say CHAO to the disease. So what is the complexity of the problems? Why do we feel the need to start such a project? Well, the complexity of the problem is that we have a new viral infection, which is very heterogeneous in the clinical outcomes, in the way it affects individual people. And it's a complex disease as it affects a lot of organs. So there is a need to understand the mechanism underlying the disease. And since the onset of the pandemic, researchers around the world have intensively investigated the biological mechanism of COVID-19, which is fantastic, of course. However, downside, it results in a tsunami of data of publication published on a daily basis. So just for the year 2020, for example, more than 120,000 publications have been recorded. And of course, this amount is continuously increasing. Furthermore, the data arrive from in vitro studies, in silico methods, in vivo studies, epidemiological or human clinical data. And currently, the knowledge and the research tends to stay in silos. There is a need for an integrated, complementary, and interdisciplinary use of the different experimental model system and data, so praising for global collaboration. A lot of initiatives emerged to provide database and forum, really in a big sense, to share and make COVID-19 data more accessible across disciplines, because cross-community research is essential. And the CHAO project fully endorse this paradigm, as his main goal is really to make sense of all this biological data available on COVID-19 by exploiting the adverse outcome pathway, as Catherine mentioned. So AOP organized the knowledge to provide a mechanistic understanding of the biological pathway along the different biological levels. So from the initial perturbation that occur at the molecular levels up to cellular, tissue, organ, and organism, with a causal relationship linking the event. So the AOP does integrate information and data from different researchers and methods, and thereby they tend to break the silos of knowledge. But besides using AOP as a tool or as a platform to synergize expertise from different fields, the CHAO project also relies on harnessing the power of crowdsourcing. So the CHAO aims at providing an international neutral forum, again here in a big sense, to facilitate interaction and to foster interdisciplinary collaborative effort, promoting thereby the integration and complementary use of different experimental models, really with the goal to better understand this complex viral disease. So as I said, AOPs integrate data from different research areas, as you can see, because AOP were originally developed to facilitate better use of mechanistic understanding in determining the toxicological properties of chemicals. In particular, the goal has been to deliver animal-free but reliable methodology for the risk assessment of the chemicals, making a greater use of the in vitro, in silico, or in chemical studies and methods. And thereby, the AOP have also a broad range of stakeholders, like molecular biologists, chemists, cellular biologists, virologists, physiologists, computational scientists, pathologists, nuclear physicists, toxicologists, ecologists, medical doctor, epidemiologists, both from industry or academia. And as I mentioned, also the AOP concept is well established in toxicology for chemical risk assessment. So for the risk assessor, and they have a regulatory purpose that can also influence the policymakers. But more recently, it is foreseen that AOP could also have a great value for biological research. So human diseases are currently classified based on clinical features rather than based on their underlying mechanism that is responsible for the different symptoms of the same disease. So a transition to a more mechanistically based disease classification could facilitate the identification and the development of personalized treatment of the various symptoms of the disease. So why do we think that, the AOP can help to make sense of this paramount amount of data available on the COVID-19 knowledge, or formulate it in a research question way? Could the AOP framework that is well established in toxicology for regulatory purposes, for assessing chemical risk assessment notably, could this toxicological framework be used to organize the knowledge on COVID-19 pathogenesis or to model a viral disease by and for the scientific community? So this research question we have developed in the published paper here, but also other scientists ask the same question, like Kim published a paper of how the adverse outcome pathway could potentially bridge the pathogenesis of COVID-19, or for the lab of Dario Greco, what nanotoxicology can teach us on COVID-19 acute responses or possible long-term consequences via the AOP. And both of those scientists are part of the Chao crowd as well. So in the Chao project, the process, which is how the AOP can help understand a viral disease, is as interesting as the output, so the AOP modeling the disease. But to better understand why we believe that AOP could help in this, I will first describe you what is an AOP. As Catherine mentioned, I think you are not all familiar with this concept. So an AOP is not a biochemical pathway. It is a framework for organizing evidence. An AOP is composed of building blocks that are the boxes that you can see here that are called key events. So a key event should not describe absolutely everything, but they are observable biological events that are essential to induce this sequence of events up to other adverse outcome. And second, they have to be measurable. That means that when building an AOP, a big part of the job is really describing and defining the methods used to measure these events. And you can see that there are two specialized events. The molecular initiating event here in green is really the starting point where the domino effects begins. So in the context of COVID-19, the binding of the spike protein of the virus to the ACE2 receptor. And at the end, you have this specific key, which is the adverse outcome in red, here exemplified with lung injury. And those endpoints have for regulatory significance in chemical risk assessment. But a really important concept in the AOP is that they are stressor aspecific, which means that another stressor, a chemical, for example, could also induce the same sequence of events up to the adverse outcome. So interconnection between unrelated diseases sharing similar key event and adverse outcome can be made, promoting the reuse of data and the reuse of knowledge. I know that often when looking at AOP, people tend to see an oversimplified description of the biology. But the meat of information is also in the key event relationship, in those arrows in between the boxes. And the key event relationships contain all the evidence that define the causal relationship between two events. When one upstream event is perturbed, the downstream event will be modified. And key event relationships are supported by biological plausibility. So it's really what's defined the mechanism that link one event to the next one. So if we have an activation of the hepatic stellate cell, then we will have an accumulation of the extracellular matrix. And we have this causal relationship between the two that is known from also other disease and past knowledge. But key event relationships are also supported by empirical evidence, including quantitative understanding. And also interestingly, the uncertainties and inconsistencies that are observed are noted. So we can have an AOP with a high weight of evidence, which means that the confidence we have in the pathway or in the sequence of events that we describe, the confidence we have is high, but we can also have an AOP with a more low weight on evidence or a more hypothetical AOP. And those later are also interesting because they help to identify knowledge gaps that could help to develop testing strategy for the chemical risk assessment, or they point out where additional research will be needed in the biomedical field. And from a modeling perspective, structuring the knowledge is, of course, really informative to develop models. So the key events give information of the type of model to use, inhibition, proliferation, etc. And all the key event measures suggest the type of data that could serve as inputs. Then the key event relationship defines the key input and output parameters relevant for model simulation. And then the quantitative understanding of the key event relationship even provide response-response relationship. So at the end of the day, AOP is intentionally a pragmatic simplification of complex biology, proposing a mode of action and a set of methods to measure it. A good analogy is that a single AOP depicts one journey. So it represents one way to go from A to B, but it doesn't represent all ways. And another really interesting concept of the AOP is that they are modular. So one key event, of course, like hepatic stellate cell activation, is not unique to one single AOP. It could be shared by different AOPs. And if two AOPs share at least one biological event, then a network occurs. So if we are back to this analogy of the Google map, if one single linear AOP describes a single path, the AOP network is really the full map to help understand the mechanism and get an overview of how they do interrelated together. So as we said, here it's an example, an AOP leading to liver fibrosis. So it starts with an initiating event, which is protein alkylation leading to cell injury, tissue resident cell activation, increased pro-inflammatory mediators, hepatic stellate cell activation, extracellular matrix alteration, and liver fibrosis. And as we said, AOP are well established in toxicology for risk assessment of chemicals. So if chemicals can induce this sequence of events, then we can foresee that we will have liver fibrosis. And this is true also for nanotoxicology here. Nanoparticles can induce endocytosis leading to lysosome disruption, then leading to cell injury, and then the rest of the AOP is shared, and we start to build a network with different stressor. But as we mentioned just before, AOP is also foreseen to have great value in depicting biomedical research, actually. And for example, the HCV envelope glycoprotein C1 and E2 binding to cell membrane induce cell injury in the liver that will also induce the rest of the sequence of events. So this type of network of AOP networks show that you can have an interdisciplinary reuse of the knowledge. But also really importantly, AOP are stored in the open access AOP wiki platform, which is coordinated by the OECD. And AOP is covering a wide variety of adverse outcomes have already been developed. So this knowledge is publicly accessible and can be reused. And AOP are therefore a living document in the sense that it can be continuously updated as new information becomes available. So what can we do? What can you do? What can I do with an AOP in the wiki? So first, you can view online or print it. So the read access is open to anyone. No account is required. And this is the address of the website. And then you can also comment it. This comment, you just need to create an account. No approvals is required. And you can also, of course, develop an AOP or edit an AOP. And for that, the author or the white access, you need to create an account, but then submit a brief developer application for approval. And ultimately, you can review some AOP, and this is the level which takes the most implication, I would say. So back to our research question, could AOP help in making sense of their knowledge on COVID-19 pathogenesis by and for the scientific community? Well, AOP are an open access platform for organizing the abundant and evolving scientific knowledge at different biological levels. So we thought that it could be really an interesting process, but how do we organize? How do we work in the, within the CHAO project? So currently more than 70 scientists from 40 different organizations worldwide are participating, from universities, NGOs, hospital industries, public or governmental organizations. So the project was initiated, is steered, and is coordinated by the European Commission, the Joint Research Center of the European Commission, the OECD, the Human Society International, and the Physician Committee for Responsible Medicine, and other scientists from a different academia. The crowd is actually divided to work in group based on the topic. So the hub, AOP working groups focus on investigating the biological mechanism common to multiple COVID-19 adverse outcomes. And the hub group joined the forces with the lung AOP group, which obviously is dealing with pulmonary related AOPs. The other organ AOP group focus on building AOPs relevant to several organs except the lung and the brain, because the neuro group focus on investigating COVID-19 AOP associated with neurological syndromes. Then the modulating factor groups examine how factor could modulate or influence the clinical outcome of the disease. And the multi-scale impact groups focus on the development of AOP beyond how SARS-CoV-2 affect the organism. And we also have a literature review groups which explore approaches of systematic literature review to support AOP development. And there is also a coordination groups which facilitate the coordination and the organization between the different working groups. And then there are different mode of collaboration. AOP developers and compile full participants to one or more working groups. CHAO junior collaborators also fully participate to one or more working groups, but they are master or PhD students and they can benefit from a tutorship from a senior scientist within the project. Then we have consultant offering occasional ad hoc expertise. And on the other side, of course, you have the AOP users. As we said, it could be scientists, clinicians, epidemiologists, among others. As we have described that AOP have a broad range of stakeholders. And the AOPs assembled in the CHAO project could help the scientific community, as I said, to identify knowledge gaps, to highlight the potential repurposing of drugs based on mechanistic understanding of the disease, or to identify relevant biomarkers. So the project actually started 1 year ago. And so now I would like to present you the different AOP that have already been developed within the different working groups. So the lung groups and the hub groups have decided to join forces, as I mentioned, to set the lung as the initial framework for everybody to use to provide some sort of basis for the development of the COVID-19 related AOPs. And the goal of these working groups is to try to explain how the viral infection leads to difficulty with breathing, hypoxia, pneumonia, extensive alveolar damage, capillary congestion, necrosis of pneumocyte, interstitial and alveolar edema, type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia, excess of surfactant, squamous metaplasia with atypia. That could then lead to the adverse outcomes such as acute respiratory distress syndromes, lung fibrosis, compression of lung tissue, damaging pulmonary capillaries, death by respiratory failure. And so in relation to the gut, to the lung, sorry, we already have AOPs developed and enter into the wiki. So they are public and they are described here, but I will describe them a bit in details in the next slide. So one of these AOP leads to lung fibrosis, starting from the binding of the S protein to the AC2 receptor, then leading to an increase of angiotensin 2, an increase of the plasma angiotensin 2 level, an increase of collagen accumulation, and then lung fibrosis. And I would like to pull your attention here to this green box I talked about already initially. So the molecular initiating event, that is the binding of the S protein to AC2 receptor, and that can be used for many AOP, as I explained. So this is the key event that is that you can find also the AOP wiki. And so the way it is done, it's with a lot of details. Is for example, there is one table that you can find in the wiki that you can see the species that can be infected by SARS-CoV-2 with all the references. So really the idea is that it's possible to use this key event, to use this knowledge as Lego to really better understand the disease. And here is another AOP on applying the same molecular initiating event, so the same green box, the same starting point where the domino effects really start to occur. But here it's leading to an enhanced viral entry and gene expression that induces increased secretion of pro-inflammatory and pro-fibrotic mediators, and then which leads to an inflammatory immune response and then acute respiratory failure. And within this AOP, I would like to briefly show detail of the second key event, which is enhanced viral entry and gene expression. As you can see here, so this key event again is publicly available on the wiki, and it's really depict or describe the increased susceptibility to viral entry, taking into account different cell type and the different host factors that contribute or mediate the viral entry. I cannot go into detail, but you can find all the information on the wiki. And this is similarly for the next key event, which goes downstream, which is the increase of coronavirus production. And in this key event, the different steps of the viral production and assembly are described in details. And again, this key event can be used in different AOP. Like here in this AOP in progress, we have the same molecular initiating event, AC2 binding to the viral S protein binding to AC2, which then leads to increased viral entry. But this time, this AOP is looking at the antiviral response that the cells can or cannot do, antagonized by the viral infection, to give information on how COVID-19 infection can be proliferating, which provide a loop. And again here, if I look into the wiki, into this key event, for the interferon response, there's the same level of details with the ORF of the virus, the different sort of proteins and the function for replicating the virus and the role in the innate immune invasion. So a complete way to provide information and make it accessible. Two other AOP related to the lung have been developed in the CHAO projects, one leading to decreased lung function through alveolar collapse, and the other one via loss of capillary membrane integrity. A final AOP leading to acute respiratory distress describe how the dysregulation of the toll-like receptor are involved and the way they control or they impact the systemic inflammatory response. And a new key event was developed for detailing the TLR dysregulation. So from here, we can move to the UB working group. So the UB part are really the biological event that can mediate a lot of the effects that are damaging to the whole body, or not a lot of the effect, but especially the central effects that are responsible for, that are common to many adverse outcomes. So you can see that it starts to be a bit more and more complex, and we start to organize a network. And actually, within the UB group, the development of the COVID-19 AOP include the implementation of previous knowledge on the UB key event for inflammation, especially for inflammation. This is really central in the COVID-19 disease. And in 2017, a workshop was organized, gathering experts to discuss and agree on the representation of the inflammatory process within the AOP. And you can find a publication of the report of this workshop there. And so many different keys were already present in the wiki and were reused as building blocks to depict the process of inflammatory response in COVID-19. Then the AOP 392 has been developed also detailing the decreased fibrinolysis and activated bradykinin system leading to hyperinflammation. This has been intensively reported in the literature. So here it's organized to really how these biological events have been measured and how it can contribute to the disease. Then the UB group look also into details in the thromboinflammation. Especially here in blue, this new key event, the focus is on the fact that platelet and neutrophil interaction increase, and this increase of the interaction leads to platelet aggregation increase and to blood clotting initiating event. because COVID-19 is associated with development of target organ damage and thromboembolic event. And this key event, this building block, represent a bridge between coagulation and inflammation-related EOP. So it's of clinical relevance. It has high potential for pharmacological intervention. So this is what has been done so far at the level of the hub and lung group. But in this multi-organ integration groups, scientists join forces and expertise to integrate the other organ into the picture, let's say. So as I said, COVID-19 is a complex disease affecting many organs. So the aim of this group is to develop multiple EOPs explaining damage to the liver, the kidney, the gut, the cardiovascular systems through direct and indirect pathways. So what do we mean by direct? Direct in our case means that when the virus can directly infect cells other than the lung cells, and indirect when the damage is the result of a systemic reaction following the infection in the lungs. So picking up on the work done in the AOP groups I just, in the AOP group that I just presented you. So the aim is really to build up a network of AOP depicting the viral disease from the molecular initiating event with the virus binding to the receptor in some cells, connecting to the central biological mechanism up to the adverse outcome in the different organs. So in that context, the putative AOP network has been proposed to describe the effect of COVID-19 on the liver, and it's published here with a direct pathway detailed here in the middle, with the virus binding to the receptor, virus replication, local inflammation, cell death, leading to liver injury, and also two indirect pathways up and down, where the liver injury is the consequence of systemic hyperinflammation and thrombosis. Also, putative AOP is leading to gastrointestinal disorder are currently under development. So it's known that AC2 expression is enriched in intestinal epithelial cells, so the enterocyte. And we also know that between 10 to 60 or 50% of the COVID-19 patients have gastrointestinal disorders, such as diarrhea. But in between, sometimes it's the black box, so we don't know the mechanism behind the disease. AOP proposed a direct pathway due to the binding of the virus into the enterocyte virus, entry and replication inducing cell death and intestinal inflammation and hyperpermeability. However, in the intestine, AC2 was also a really key role in intestinal homeostasis. It acts as a co-receptor for nutrient uptake, the dietary amino acids, and AC2 dysregulation leads to the area that is known in other disease, and it's also associated with alteration of gut microbiota. So here another mechanism is proposed as that is due to AC2 dysregulation that can induce intestinal inflammation and hyperpermeability. And finally, the indirect pathway, look into this gut-lung axis. So the fact that systemic hyperinflammation and intestinal inflammation, leaky gut syndromes are interconnected. And here again, the different experimental models and derived data are used to strengthen the confidence we can have in this proposed mode of action to explain why some COVID-19 patients experience gastrointestinal disorder and some other do not. Also using in vivo study that have been already done for other disease. And so reusing knowledge from the past. Then we have the neuro group. In the neuro group, four neuro AOPs are under development and three are already in the wiki. And the AOPs address the major adverse outcome that have been associated with the effect of SARS-CoV-2 on the nervous system. And the first one is, for example, anosmia, so the loser smell. So here again, we have the AC2 binding, the S protein binding to AC2, which induce virus replication, death of system tacular cells, death of the olfactory sensory neuron, degeneration of the olfactory epithelium and anosmia. But an AOP also to detail what happened in the case of encephalitis or stroke has also been developed, and we can also start to build a smaller neuro network in the context of the COVID-19. Then the next working groups explore how to bridge systematic review approaches or comprehensive culture search with AOP development. So a pilot study has been undertaken, which aim at identifying literature that contains information about neurological outcomes related to COVID-19. So the title and abstract have been successfully screened, and the full text screening began using Swift Active Screener and the license I provided for free of charge by SIOM. And we have also, for example, Katja Chuan from the Evidence-Based Toxicology Collaboration and John Hopkins-Bloomberg, which is also working in these working groups, but also previously tried to bridge these two communities to really help promote the utilization of systematic reviews to reduce and replace animal use in science. So each full text is reviewed independently by two reviewers for inclusion, exclusion. Any conflicts between the reviewers are flagged by the software. The paper with conflicting judgment are assessed by the working groups. A final decision is made after discussion. And I think that so far I try to update the value. So the screenshot is a bit old, but it's almost completed this phase. And know that we work together with the neuro group to see how all this systematic review can help in the development of the AOP. Then we have the modulating factor group. So here, the group really try to identify which factors have an impact on the course and the progression and the severity of the disease and how these factors interfere with the process of the disease. So we try to identify those factors. The list is for sure not exhaustive, and we didn't explore them yet in depth. However, the first one is sex. Of course, it is well known that men and women COVID-19 patients experience different clinical outcomes. And then we look also at the age, which actually includes, besides the biological age, it also includes the aging of the immune system, and also the fact that we have increasing comorbidities, and comorbidities itself could also be seen as a modulating factor. And here we have kind of a long list of comorbidities that clearly have been shown to influence the outcome of the disease. Diabetes, hypertension, obesity, cardiac diseases, malignant tumors, lipid disorders, immune disorders are all factors that modulate or influence the progression of COVID-19. Then we have the lifestyle factors, such as diet or smoking, or the environmental factors, such as chemicals, PFAS, to give an example, and air pollution. The drugs or the therapeutic intervention, the genetic factors, and here, for example, the blood groups, influence are known to influence the thrombotic events. We show that they are central in the progression of the disease. The microbiota that here can be seen more as a precondition. So you have an alteration of the microbiota, or dysbiosis before the infection, then it will also modulate or influence the severity of the disease. The vitamin D status and the socioeconomic factors we know are also influencing the outcome of the disease, but they are more discussed in the other working groups I will present you. And also what is really important is actually all those factors, they do interact with each other. So it's kind of sometimes difficult to evaluate how they do interact. And that's why we think to work with AOP networks will also help. So the modulating factor can either have an effect on the key-event relationship. So that means they change the relation of the shape of the causal relationship between one event and the other. But the modulating factor can also interfere with the key-event, so the biological event itself, as a mechanism of several chemicals might share biological event and they can modulate then the outcome. So here we really try to see where and how do these modulating factor interfere with the different biological events that have been depicted in the AOPs. So here you can see, for example, that sex can interfere or modulate the EC2 receptor binding or the viral replication, the TLR9 activation or the increase of pre-inflammatory mediators. If we look at PFAS, they are also modulating oxidative stress, or leukocyte recruitment and activation are also, if we look at the effect of diet, and here the scientists working with us look at the GBH, as it has been shown to influence the RAS system, oxidative stress, endothelial cell disruption. So really here, we will try by using this AOP depicting COVID-19 to understand how the factors interfere. And what we can already see is that the initial events are related to the virus, and the inflammatory response are also where the factors really interfere heavily. Then we have also a multi-scale impact group. So the groups aim to elucidate the multi-scale factor of COVID-19 and future pandemics, of all the central goal on having a direct impact on resilience and outcomes for individuals and society, and evolve the AOP framework to achieve understanding and impact across levels and time at different time scale. So how to evolve the AOPs, which means taking AOPs to the next level and broadening the application, consider the spatiotemporal scale, consider the dynamic feedback, inhibition, excitation, and also consider that all these mechanisms can lead to not only to an adverse outcome, but maybe to a beneficial outcome. Rethinking also the visualization and having prevention example. Finally, another team aims at building a COVID-19 AOP network with integrating the 15 AOPs I just presented you that are already into the wiki and that have been built actually with 59 keys, 26 that were already into the wiki, and 33 that have been developed specifically within CHAO. And those COVID-19 related AOP, as I said, they either depict adverse outcome in the lung or in the brain, or linked, to neurological syndromes or to hub events, it's a hyperinflammation and thrombotic event, or liver or gastrointestinal disorder. And we put all of them into this network. And we believe that to have them all in a network will help to better understand the interrelation between the various outcomes. But importantly as well, again, by building such a COVID-19 AOP network, which permits to identify knowledge gaps. So here's really a preliminary network, but you can see in red some knowledge gaps that we have identified so far that could be really useful to know where research maybe should focus to increase our understanding of the disease, to define a strategy of which assays should be done. But also it's provide a mechanistic understanding for 3R-driven data generation, and it's also aid developing mathematical models. So to go back to what I said initially, that AOPs have a broad range of stakeholders. The end users of the COVID-19 AOP are equally interdisciplinary as the developers, due to the principle of the AOP framework that are stressor specific, that are modular, that are pragmatic sequences, so abstract of detailed research, the interconnection between unrelated diseases can be made when they are sharing similar biological events, and they are living documents. So indeed, all this AOP could be input for pharmacologists to align the potential repurposing of drugs for clinicians, to identify relevant biomarker of the disease progression to better understand the individual outcomes, but also for toxicologists, biologists, and all the scientific community, building on this unique opportunity provided by this pandemic to better understand human biology based on this immense amount of data arising from the crisis. So taking this paramount of data as an asset. So we are still developing AOP and building the project. So here I would like to thank you for the attention. And if you want to know more about the project and the output that we have reached so far, or if you might be interested in joining the collaborative projects, we have a website of the project. So don't hesitate to have a look to the website, or don't hesitate to contact us. That would be with pleasure. So thank you very much for your attention.